Welcome to r/maliciouscompliance, where we share stories of people conforming to the letter, but not the spirit of a request. And today's first story is, baseball caps on girls is distracting. In high school, my standard outfit included a backward flat rim baseball cap. One teacher, in the middle of class, called me out. OP, you need to take off your hat. It's distracting. What about the 13 other guys in this class with a similar hat? Well, it's distracting when a girl wears a baseball cap. I was fuming. Baseball caps on girls are distracting? Fine, I won't wear one. The next class period, I wore a 3-foot-tall red and yellow Joker hat that featured bells, so that if I moved my head at all, 16 bells shook. At the end of an hour and a half of bells, the teacher pulled me aside to ask that I go back to my baseball cap. Apparently, it was no longer distracting. The second story is, couldn't join a club that would have you. Some years ago, I was finally out of debt and ready to start investing for my future, but I didn't have a clue how. That's when I heard about a national organization that promoted investment clubs, offering support and tools to help people like me learn about investing by doing it. I like the idea. Get smarter, play low stakes, and maybe have a beer or two while you do it. So I told a few friends, they talked to their friends, and pretty soon we had a budding investment club. Since we were all friends of friends, organizing went smoothly. We elected officials and adopted a simple charter based on the national group's templates. Minimum monthly dues were set at $10, an amount any one of us could afford to throw away. But any member could contribute more than the minimum if they liked, and to build up our investing pot, most of us did. Individual contributions bought shares in the club's holdings, like stock in a corporation. Higher contributions meant more shares, meant more voting power when we made club decisions. As we got rolling, a few more people heard about the club and expressed interest, so we created a little process, attend 3 meetings as the guest of a member. Then, if you're still interested, club members decide whether to offer an invitation. We always did. Sign the charter, pay this month's dues, and you're in. Most new members paid extra for at least a while to catch up to the voting power of the founding members, so everyone stood on more or less equal footing. By year 2, we had settled into a friendly routine, holding monthly meetings that were one part socializing, one part learning, and one part considering what to do with our growing little pot of cash. We picked a few stocks, started buying a few shares at a time, and portfolio performance was added to the monthly treasurer's report. We cheered each modest gain and learned from our small losses. Then came Pat. Pat was an outlier in our friend group. Most of us knew her, but few knew her well. She had a reputation for being a little too loud, a little too blunt, a little too cocky, a little too rude. But was she also known to be smart? In a club focused on learning, more smart couldn't hurt, right? Besides, our well-respected president had brought her in. And right away, Pat proved she was smart. She had reviewed our charter and our past minutes before she came to her first meeting. She asked solid questions about past decisions and our reasoning. She listened respectfully to the education and stock study presentations, probing politely, and made mostly appreciative comments after each meeting. Just a bit of smart A thrown in once in a while, but we could handle a bit. After her third meeting, we sent her to the next room while we discussed inviting her to join us. There were a few misgivings expressed. We had all heard stories about Pat's capacity for unpleasantness after all. But President said, I warned her pretty bluntly that she needs to behave when she's here. We're all friends, but this is business. Money is serious. So I told her, keep yourself in check. Leave your attitude outside. Ultimately, everyone agreed. She had indeed behaved. We had no reason to doubt her sincere interest. So we called Pat back in, and President said, congratulations, Pat. Just pay your dues and sign here. With a flourish, Pat handed Treasurer a $10 bill, and everyone applauded as she signed the charter. Then she said, thank you all, thank you, but frankly, you really don't have any way to keep me out. The room got quieter. Then she turned to Treasurer and said, now next month, if I'm interpreting your little reports correctly, all I have to do is give you X dollars and I'll have equal voting rights, is that right? That's about right, yes, came the answer. And if I were to give you that plus, and here she pointed at the bottom line of the club's total holdings, XX dollars, I'd become the new majority shareholder, right? I suppose. And then I'd be in charge of all club decisions, declared Pat. That's right. Unless you all can keep ponying up more cash than I can, there's nothing you can do to stop me from running this club, like my own private account, with nearly double my money to play with, is there? And now that I've signed your silly charter, you don't even have any way to kick me out. So, see you all next month. She smirked, turned and left. The door had just barely closed when the room exploded. She was joking, right? Ah, heck no. The nerve. Could she really do that? That can't be real. How big a mistake did we just make? Wow, what a class A B. But as we looked over our template-based charter, we found she was right. There were requirements for tax reporting. officer fiscal responsibilities, bank and brokerage relationships, conflicts of interest, and a host of other issues we'd never faced and never expected to face. There was boilerplate language about how to buy out a voluntarily withdrawing member. There was a provision allowing us to involuntarily withdraw someone who didn't keep up with the dues and/or attendance. But we had no cap on individual member contributions, and no provision allowing us to kick out a stakeholder as long as they continued to pay their dues and attend meetings. And we now realize that if she could make good on her threat to buy majority holding, Pat could simply outvote any attempt to amend our charter. A more elegant solution probably existed, but within 20 minutes, someone came up with the nuclear option. 2 minutes later, we agreed to launch it. We accepted assignments, then went our separate ways to prepare for next month's meeting. That evening, everyone arrived a bit more promptly and settled a lot more quietly than usual. Pat looked smug as she took a seat, seeming not to care that no one spoke to her. She was ostentatiously fanning herself with a personal check. Too bad we never saw it, so we'll never know if she was really ready to put her money where her mouth had been. President took the floor. Before I call the meeting to order, I have a personal announcement to make. I made a really poor recommendation to all of you last month. I feel the bad judgment I showed means I am not fit to be your president. I'm presenting my letter of resignation and my voluntary withdrawal from the club, and solemnly gave the letter to secretary. Pat looked like she'd been slapped, but she said nothing. Treasurer spoke up. Just so you all know, President spoke to me earlier about this decision, so I've already calculated withdrawal payout and have it ready according to the terms of our charter, and President took the check. Vice President spoke next. President, you weren't alone in that decision. I voted with you, and I also regret my poor judgment. Here is my letter of resignation and withdrawal. Treasurer said, and here is your withdrawal payout, prepared as we discussed. And on it went, in small clusters at first, then all in a rush. Each club member declared they'd made a terrible decision, presented a letter, and collected an already prepared check. Sometime during the rush, Pat stopped being silent. Okay, I see. Yeah, I get it. Seriously, you've made your point. That's enough now. You don't have to keep up this act. Knock it off already, you effers. But we didn't. With all the letters collected, Secretary added them to the back of a fat binder containing copies of all the club minutes and gave the binder to Pat. Your next club secretary will need this. Treasurer was right behind with a similar binder of financial records, a $10 bill on top. Here are all your club's accounting records and remaining assets. President added the signed charter to the stack. So Pat, looks like you're now a club of one. You win. Good luck and goodbye. We all stood and stared silently until she shoved the stack to the floor and saw herself sputtering to the door. Within 10 minutes, we had signed our newly upgraded charter, re-elected our officers, torn up all our payout checks, and put our new club back to business as usual. Okay, maybe just a bit more giggly and a little bit more pleased with ourselves than usual. Never saw Pat again. Didn't care. The third story is renewed lease with management company, but owner doesn't want any tenants after current lease period is over. Whatever you say. Another post about landlord shenanigans in college reminded me of this story. I thought the sub might get a kick out of. I moved into a place in a college town, and it seemed perfect. Low rent, newly refurbished, backyard for my dog, included washer and dryer, etc., etc. The one problem I had was the owner. Even though he hired a property management company to collect rent and manage the property, he would constantly drop by to look over the property, saying he would renovate this or that part of the house, or just stay and shoot the bull after I gave him multiple not-so-subtle hints that I wanted him to leave. His son had previously lived in the unit, so it seemed he was used to being able to come by whenever he wanted. And as a retiree, he very often wanted to stop by. Well, at the time, the state I lived in required 24-hour notice for when a landlord or management company could drop in unannounced. Edit. Needed to notify you before they showed up at the residence. Also, in my lease, it specifically stated that any contact between the owner and myself needed to go through the management company. So, being tired of an old man hanging around my house, I called the management company to ask them to remind the owner that all communication from the landlord goes through them, and for them to tell him to give 24 hours notice before stopping by, as stated in the tenant laws. He did not like this. I'll also say that in college towns, property management companies really want to know if you're renewing a lease within a few months of you moving out. They typically run on a schedule similar to semesters, as far as when people move in and out of their properties. I moved into this place in January, and they went as far as letting themselves into my house to leave a note, asking me to let them know whether or not I was renewing my lease 2 weeks after I had moved in, as I had signed a 6-month lease. Not sure why they couldn't just send an email, mail the letter, or call me, but I think they learned their lesson about being pushy that day, as I was doing yoga in my underwear that morning, and the poor girl they sent over to deliver the renewal letter was probably traumatized for life after seeing my fat A and downward dog. Anyways, I liked the place enough to renew, and signed a year-long lease renewal. About 3 months later in March, I get a text from the owner saying that he heard I was interested in renewing my lease, but that his daughter had been accepted into the university, so he wanted her to stay there. This was confusing to me, because A, he should have gone through the management company to talk to me, and B, I had a lease contract already signed by the rental company and him. I call the management company to sort this out, and the conversation goes something like this. Me: so the owner of the property I'm living in contacted me to say that he isn't interested in leasing the property anymore. Company representative, CR: oh yes, it looks like the property won't be available next year. Me: okay, but I have a lease signed by both your company and the owner for the next year. CR: well, I'm sorry, but the owner no longer wants to lease the property out. We can help find you a new property in the area if you like. I had read the lease pretty closely, and at this point I had the suspicion that the owner and this company thought I would just roll over because they said so. Unfortunately for them, I was about to come back with some malicious compliance to their own lease. Me: so you're saying that your company is breaking the lease contract we have for next year? CR: whoa, nobody's talking about breaking any contracts with anybody. Me: that's what you just said. I have a lease for this place with your company, but the owner doesn't want a lease. We have a contract, but you're unable to fulfill the contract because the owner is backing out. CR: no, this is something you need to sort out with the owner because he's backing out of your lease. Me: by our current and renewed lease agreements, all contact between myself and the owner is required to go through your company. I already renewed the lease for next year with signatures from both your company and the owner. At this point, the disagreement is between you and the owner over whether he wants to back out of the lease we all signed. Good luck sorting it out. We went back and forth like this for a while, and eventually I got passed up the chain at the management company to one of the owners. While I was waiting, likely because they were scrambling to come up with some way to convince me my complaint was a lost cause, I was reading my lease and noticed some vague wording having to do with the company being responsible for accommodations during periods when the property is unavailable or inaccessible. I spoke to the management company owner shortly after this. Management company owner, MCO: I know property owner personally, and there's no disagreement between us about this property being available. He wants his daughter to live there next year, so we're not renting it out. Me: that's your prerogative, but at this point are you breaking our lease contract? MCO: no one is breaking the contract. Me: okay, then if you're saying you want to keep our contract, but the house will be inaccessible because the owner won't rent it out, then you're willing to put me up somewhere else for the duration of the lease for free. I pointed out in the lease where this statement was, and the MCO hung up the phone. I'm no lawyer, but the management company probably could have argued that wasn't the intention of the clause. Seemed to be more pointed at pest infestation, but was listed in a general section of the lease. I'm pretty sure they just gave it up because I didn't hear from them about this after that conversation. They must have decided it wasn't worth the hassle from me and told the property owner that they had his signature on a contract they weren't going to break, or honor under the circumstances of paying for me to live somewhere free for a year. There were some half-hearted texts from the property owner after that threatening to evict me, but I did end up staying another year there. And the last story is, Tailgater wants to pass me. Be my guest. I commute on a stretch of 95 north of DC, which is routinely patrolled by police. It was just before Labor Day, so they were particularly visible in the days leading up to it. I drive 73 in the 65-mile-per-hour stretch, knowing it's just enough to keep me from being ticketed. Apparently, this was not fast enough for the guy behind me. He rides my bumper for half a mile, flashing his high beams wanting me to move over. We were coming up to the crest of a hill, at the bottom of which is a favorite spot for the state police to stake out. I obligingly pull over one lane as we reach the top. He guns it and speeds past me, down the hill, straight into the waiting arms of a speed trap. Whatever your hurry was, you're a bit later now. I hope you enjoyed these stories. Thank you for listening.